فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل، وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، أما بعد. وإن شرح ذا كتاب نواقض الإسلام written by شيخ الإسلام محمد ابن عبد الوهاب رحمه الله تعالى. We were in the first ناقض, the first nullifier. Now inshallah ta'ala we're going to move on to the seventh point that's missing from us. المسألة السابعة. The seventh point on the first ناقض, the first nullifier. Which is, as shirk occurs, and we established shirk occurs in belief, and it also occurs on the limbs, it can also occur on a person's utterance and statements. Shirk can happen from statements a person says. And an example for that is, number one, al-hilfu bi ghayri Allah, if a person swears by other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is shirk, but it's what? Shirk. Asghar, it's a minor shirk. As long as the person does not venerate or glorify the person in which they are swearing by, كَتَعْظِيمِ اللَّهِ, the way that they venerate and honor Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or even greater. As long as they don't do that, then it won't be shirk akbar, but it will be shirk asghar, either way. So if the person honors the person which they are swearing by, they're honoring them, venerating them, like they honor Allah and they venerate Allah, it becomes shirk akbar. Or if they honor them greater than Allah, and they believe and they venerate this individual over Allah, then this becomes shirk akbar. But if the person doesn't do it for that, then it remains shirk asghar. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said in the hadith, Abdullah ibn Umar narrated, Tirmidhi brought it in his sunan, Albani rahimahullah, he authenticated it in his kitab Al-Irwa' Al-Ghareeb, hadith 2561, that the Prophet said, Man halafa bighayri Allahi faqad ashrak. Anyone who swears by other than Allah, he has what? He has come with what? Shirk. So anyone who swears by other than Allah, so if you say, I swear down, and I swear down means I swear those in the grave, then this is shirk the person has come with. If the person says, I swear by my mom, it's also shirk. I swear by my mom's life, shirk. So if it's done with the intention of venerating this individual, if you're trying to venerate this person, you're trying to glorify them above Allah, then of course it's shirk akbar. Equal to Allah is also shirk akbar. ولذلك سليمان بن عبد الله رحمه الله said in his kitab التيسير, which is a sharh of kitab التوحيد, when he was mentioning the hadith of hadith الطفيل ابن سخبرة, he mentioned some benefits, which is وَإِنَّكُمْ قُلْتُمْ كَلِمَةً كَانَ يَمْنَعُنِي كَذَا وَكَذَا أَنَّهَا كُمُ عَنْ أنهاكم عنها. نعم. So Sheikh Sulaiman رحمه الله, he mentions that this statement. So he says from the story of Tufayl ibn Sakhbara. The story, I did write the hadith by the wording, I'm miswriting it. He mentions that, and the hadith asal is in Ahmad's Musnad and Tabarani's Mu'jam, like I never wrote it. That he takes from this the impermissibility of a person swearing by what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said and saying statements that would what? Would entail that. Number two, another example for something that a person should not say, which falls under shirk of utterance, is مَا شَاءَ اللَّهُ وَشِئْتَ, if Allah wills and you will, O Muhammad. Sometimes we say, oh, I was depending on you, I was fully depending on you. Another problem. Okay? If it wasn't for you, brother, this would have all messed up. These statements, they are dangerous. Qutaybah radiallahu ta'ala anha, she said, أَنَّ يَهُودِيًا أَتَى النَّبِيُّ أَنَّ يَهُودِيًا أَتَى النَّبِيَّ صلى الله عليه وسلم. A Jew man came to the Prophet. And he said to the Prophet, إِنَّكُمْ تُشْرِكُونَ. You guys, you Muslims, associate partner with Allah. The Jew man said, تَقُولُونَ. You guys say, مَا شَاءَ اللَّهُ وَشِئْتَ. If Allah wills, and then Muhammad wills. You connect Allah's will with Muhammad's will. وَتَقُولُونَ. And you Muslims say, وَالْكَعْبَةَ. فَأَمَرَهُمُ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. And the Prophet commanded the believers that if they want to swear, they have to say, وَرَبُّ الْكَعْبَةَ. And if they want to say, they have to say, مَا شَاءَ اللَّهُ ثُمَّ شَاءَ مُحَمَّد. If Allah wills, and then if after that Muhammad wills. Sheikh Al-Albani authenticated that in his Silsila Hadith al-Sahihah, and Sheikh Muqbil ibn Hadi al-Wadi'i in his Sahih al-Musnad. A man came to the Prophet one time and he said to him, عليه الصلاة والسلام, أن رجلا جاء إلى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فقال ما شاء الله. A man came to the Prophet and he said to him, if Allah wills and you will. فقال له النبي, the Prophet said to him, أجعلتني, did you make me لله ندا, did you make me equal to Allah. قل, say ما شاء الله وحده, say if only Allah wills. Sheikh Nasir authenticated that in his Silsila Hadith al-Sahihah, and both of the narrations that I mentioned, this one and the one before it, they are both found in Sunan Nasa'i. So what a person needs to know is that a statement that you say, that you utter, can be what? Shirk. Just like an action that you do can be what? Shirk Akbar. That swearing by Allah or saying, if Allah wills and Muhammad wills, can, its asal is that it's shirk asghar. And if a person comes with some particular matters, what is it? It turns to be what? It turns out to be shirk akbar. For example, if they believe that this thing and Allah are equal, then it becomes kufra, shirk akbar. If they believe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is lower and this is higher, then of course it's shirk akbar. The eighth point is عدم الخوف من الشرك. Not being scared of shirk is an evidence of weak tawheed. If a person does not fear shirk, it shows and it's an indication of weak tawheed. Nabiullah Ibrahim, Khalilullah Ibrahim, he called on to his Lord, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Ibrahim, what did he ask Allah to prevent him from? Huh? What is it that Ibrahim asked Allah to prevent him from, or protect him from? Yeah? Don't just say shirk. The most obvious type of shirk. The most obvious type of shirk. The shirk that Ibrahim knew as a child when he was young. He destroyed idols. He destroyed idols as a young kid. He knows shirk. But even then, what did he say? وَإِذْ قَالَ إِبْرَاهِيمُ. When Ibrahim said, رَبِّ جَعَلْ هَذَا الْبَلَدَ آمِنًا. Oh Allah, make this land safe. Protect it and make it safe. آمِنًا وَجْنُبْنِي. Divert me. وَبَنِيَ أَنْ نَعْبُدَ الْأَصْنَامِ. Divert me and my children, my offspring, from worshipping idols. So Nabiullah Ibrahim was what? Was scared of the most famous, the most common type of what? Shirk. And was worried about it. So if a person says, why are you guys talking about Tawheed? Isn't Tawheed something we know? We're not worried about shirk. Then we say, now we even know more that you need to study Tawheed. Sah? We need to study At-Tawheed. ولذلك the Prophet said to his companions, أَخْوَفُ مَا أَخَافُ عَلَيْكُمْ. What I fear the most for you is what? الشِّرْكُ الْأَصْغَرُ. The Prophet said, what I fear the most for you is the minor shirk. I fear that one the most for you. So, the author here goes, we're still in the first naqidh, he said, وَمِنْهُ ذَبْحُ لِغَيْرِ اللَّهِ. From amongst it is what? From amongst it is what? الذَبْحُ. الذَبْحُ لِغَيْرِ اللَّهِ. الذَبْحُ لِغَيْرِ اللَّهِ is from the types that we mentioned. that will take you out of the fold of Islam. If Shirk Akbar is giving a practical example for right now, the author, Muhammad Abdullah. وَمِنْهُ from the Shirk Akbar is what? And the first naqid, and from the first nullifier is adhabhul ghayriya. That's an example for you to know. The ninth point that we take from that statement is إِثْبَاتُ كَوْمُ ذَبْحِ عِبَادَةُ لِلَّهِ. Slaughtering for other than Allah is an ibadah. And what you need to know is, a ibadah is something you get closer to what? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If a person goes and he slaughters for somebody other than Allah, he slaughters for them, then this becomes what? Shirk Akbar. And it will take away from the person, it will take away from them, the person, the tawheed, the asl iman, which that the person has. What's the evidence for that? That slaughtering is an ibadah. Where's the evidence? Allah says in the Quran, فَصَلِّ لِرَبِّكَ. Pray to your Lord, one harm and slaughter. Surah Al-Kawthar, right? Ayah 2. فَصَلِّ, pray to your Lord and what? And slaughter. So, two things show us that the slaughter is an ibadah. Number one is the fact that Allah connected it next, He connected it to prayer. فَصَلِّ, pray to your Lord, one har and also slaughter. They're both connected because they both are ibadah. Second is that both of them are commanded. Allah doesn't command what's not an ibadah. Sah? Allah commanded it, one har, slaughter. He said what? One har. And we know the term, and anything Allah commands is something He is what? He loves and He's pleased with. And what's the definition of an ibadah? اسم جامع لكل ما يحبه الله ويرضاه من الأقوال والأعمال الظاهرة والباطنة. It's a general term which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's a general term, and it's anything which Allah loves, is pleased with. It's anything Allah loves and is what? It's anything Allah loves and He is pleased with, whether it's external or internal. So how do we know Allah loves it? Because He commanded it. He commanded it subhanahu wa ta'ala. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, he said in his Majmu' al-Fatawa, the 16th volume, page 531, he says, أمر الله تعالى, Allah commanded, أن يجمع بين هاتين العبادتين العظيمتين, that they bring together these two great ibadahs, salah and وهما الصلاة والنسك, the slaughtering and the prayer, الدالتان على القرب والتواضع, because they both indicate getting closer to Allah and humiliation and humbleness to Him. That's what it shows. Intaha kalamu. Point number 10 that we take from this is that anything that has been established, it's an ibadah. أَنَّمَا ثَبَتَ كَوْنُ عِبَادَةً لِلَّهِ وَحْدَهِ. Anything that has been established that it's an ibadah for Allah, it is not permissible for you to divert it for anybody other than Him. Once it's been established that this is an ibadah now, and it falls under the definition of an ibadah, then it is not permissible for you to divert it to anybody other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if you do, then you fall into major shirk. So we proved that dhabh, slaughtering, is a what? It's min al-ibadat, it's from the ibadat. And la yutaqarrabu biha illa ila Allah azza wa jalla. You can't get closer to it except to Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. So anybody who slaughters for a jinn, wanting to get close to that jinn, okay? Or he diverts it for anyone other than that, this is what? Shirk. He does it for the dead, it's shirk. He does it for the awliya, it's shirk. He fell into what? He fell into Shirk Akbar. We're now going to move on to, after those 10 nawaqid that we mentioned, we're going to now move on to al-naqid al-thani, the second naqid, the second nullifier, the second thing that nullifies a person's belief and takes away from them the asl al-iman, the foundation of your iman. You are no longer a believer anymore. And this is man ja'ala baynahu wa bayna Allahi wasa'it. It is anybody who places between him and Allah a intermediary. يدعوهم, he calls on to the intermediaries. ويسألهم, and he asks them, الشفاعه intercession كفر اجماعا. They are kuffar by consent. There's no dispute in this regard. Now, some may think that this naqidh, this nullifier, is a reputation. That this nullifier is a what? It's a reputation of the what? The first naqidh. And the reality is, laysa tikraran lil-awwali. It's not a repetition of the first one. It is not a repetition of the first. The first one was general. Okay? The first one was what? It was very general. This one, on the other hand, is more specific. And this is what the scholars, they call atful khasi ala al-ammi. Atful khasi ala al-ammi is when you connect a specific to a what? A general. وهذا لبيان. And the author, the reason why he did this is to clarify the danger of this and how much it occurs within the people when they really don't realize what's happening. Are we all together? This is something that occurs from so many people, but they really don't think that it falls under the first one, or they think that what they are doing is not Shirk Akbar. So the Shaykh is bringing it as an independent nullifier. Why? كثرت وقوع الناس, majority of the people, they fall into this a lot. حيث لا يشعرون, when they really don't feel that what they are doing is what? What they are doing is a nullifier that's taken away from them the asalul iman. And that point is what Sheikh Salih Al-Fawzan said when he was explaining the waqf of Islam. That's what he said. Point number one is that الإجماع, there's a consent على كفر من فعل هذا الفعل. Anyone who does this action, there's an إجماع, there's a consent. Many ulama have transmitted the consent. Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, he brought a consent in his kitab الواسطة بين الحق والباطل. الواسطة بين الحق والخلق. الواسطة بين الحق والخلق, page 116 to 121. Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah, he brings that this matter is a consent. Okay? Also, if you look at the kitab Kashf al-Qina', 6th volume, page 168. If you go to the kitab As-Sawa'iq al-Mursala by Sulaiman ibn Sahman, you find page 154, he also brings a consent. All these ulama, they bring consensus in their books. What does the word wasa'it mean? What does wasa'it mean? Wasa'it is jam'u wasita. It's a plural of the word wasita. What does a wasita mean? Wahiya, it is ma yutawassalu bihi ila shay. It is the means for reaching a goal that you want to reach. It's in English, it's an intermediary. The word wasita, the plural is wasa'it, is basically the intermediary in the middle. And the intent here that the author brought it is, أن من أثبت وسائط بين الله, anyone who establishes and places between himself and the creation, between himself, sorry, and Allah, a thing to get to Allah. So he says, I can't get to Allah directly. No. I need that means to get to Him. I need that intermediary that gets me to Allah. Anyone who does that, just like the leader and the king has a hujab. Hujab are those who are around the king. If you want to get to the king, you can't get to him unless you go through them. Okay? You have to go through them. Once they'll take your matter to the leader. Anyone who does that for Allah and says that Allah is like the creation like that, that you can't go to him straight away directly, then you've fallen into major shirk. That's what the Shaykh is talking about. And Allah told us in the Quran that this is exactly what the disbelievers of Quraysh were doing. Allah said in the Quran, وَيَعْبُدُونَ, they worship, مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ, besides Allah, مَا لَا يَضُرُّهُمْ That which does not harm them. وَلَا يَنْفَعُهُمْ And it doesn't benefit them. وَيَقُولُونَ And they say, هَؤُلَاءِ شُفَعَاؤُنَا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ And they say, these are our intermediaries, our intercessors to Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. These things that we're worshipping and we're calling onto are what? They are shufa'a, intercessors for us. They intercede on our behalf. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He refuted and responded to that false belief of theirs. And that the matter really isn't as they claim. So He said to them, قُلْ أَتُنَبِّئُونَ اللَّهَ بِمَا لَا يَعْلَمُ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَلَا فِي الْأَرْضِ Are you guys telling Allah? قُلْ أَتُنَبِّئُونَ اللَّهَ Are you guys going to inform Allah? بِمَا لَا يَعْلَمُ That which is not known in the samawat and the ard. سبحانه وتعالى عما يشركون. Allah also says in another ayah, وَالَّذِينَ اتَّخَذُوا مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ أَوْلِيَاءَ مَا نَعْبُدُهُمْ إِلَّا لِيُقَرِّبُونَ إِلَى اللَّهِ زُلْفَى إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَحْكُمُ بَيْنَهُمْ فِيمَا هُمْ فِيهِ يَخْتَلِفُونَ Allah tells us in this ayah, وَالَّذِينَ اتَّخَذُوا مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ أَوْلِيَاءَ Those who have taken besides Allah intermediaries. This is what they say. مَا نَعْبُدُهُمْ We do not worship these things that we're worshipping. These intermediaries, these shuyukhs, these ulama, these pirsabs. Huh? We don't worship them. إِلَّا لِيُقَرِّبُونَ إِلَى اللَّهِ زُلْفَى The only reason why we do it is so that they can get us closer to what? They can get us closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah then says in the Quran, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَحْكُمُ Allah will judge them. بَيْنَهُمْ Between them. فِيمَا هُمْ فِيهِ يَخْتَلِفُونَ That which they disputed in. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَهْدِي Allah does not guide مَنْ هُوَ كَاذِبٌ A person who is a liar. كَفَّار Who's a disbeliever. So Allah referred to them as a what? Disbelievers. So if those people claim that they are Muslims and they say we are Muslims, it still doesn't stop them from being what? From being liars and from being disbelievers. They are liars and they are what? Disbelievers. Look at the Kitab Al-Wasita Bayn Al-Haqq Wal-Khalq by Shaykh Al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah. Point number three. Two was the definition, yeah. The first one was the consensus that the person does this. Point number three, the first point was the consensus of the person who does this action is a disbeliever. The second point was the definition, right? The third one now, inshaAllah ta'ala, is the types of wasa'id. The types of wasa'id there are. The wasa'id is categorized, تَنْقَسِمُ الْوَسَائِطِ إِلَىٰ قِسْمَيْنِ It's categorized into how many types? Into two types. The first one is, الْقِسْمُ الْأَوَّلِ is a wasa'id, which is شَرْعِيَّة. Legislated intermediaries. Legislated wasa'id. Are we all together? The first one is actually sanctioned, it's legislated, it's permitted. Okay? And that is those who are between Allah and the creation. They are between Allah and the what? And the creation. In what lacking? They are between Allah in the creation by conveying the message to the people. There's no way that the creation could know this message except through these messengers and prophets. Sah? These prophets are what tell us Allah, what Allah loves. These messengers are what tell us what Allah hates. There's no other way that we could know, right? Is there? No, there's no other way we could know. The only way that we could know what Allah loves and what He's pleased with subhanahu wa ta'ala is through what? The prophets and that? The messengers. That's what we say to the people who pray in a particular way. Who sanctioned this prayer? Where? Because you didn't meet Allah. So you have to go through the Prophet in order to tell us what Allah loves. That's an intermediary. That wasa'id is sanctioned. Are we all together? So you say to me, the Prophet said you can pray like this. Where did he say it? Good. Does that make sense? These are the first type, which is the sanctioned type. Allah says in the Quran, رُسُلًا مُبَشِّرِينَ وَمُنْدِرِينَ They are messengers who are giving what? Warning. They're also giving glad tidings. So there is not for the people. عَلَى اللَّهِ حُجَّةٌ بَعْدَ الرُّسُلِ, that the messengers don't have no proof anymore. They don't have no proof. وَكَانَ اللَّهُ عَزِيزًا حَكِيمًا. So رُسُلَ مُبَشِّرِينَ وَمُنذِرِينَ لِأَلَّا يَكُونَ لِلنَّاسِ عَلَى اللَّهِ حُجَّةٌ بَعْدَ الرُّسُلِ وَكَانَ اللَّهُ عَزِيزًا حَكِيمًا. No one can come and say, oh, the message wasn't brought to me. I didn't know what Allah loved and I didn't know what Allah hated. I didn't know what Allah wanted from me and I didn't know what Allah didn't want from me. I knew none of that. We'll say, okay, Jameel. Did prophets come? Did these prophets convey their message? Yes. Then they were the intermediaries between Allah and the creation for the people to know what Allah wants and what Allah doesn't want. Allah says in another, the ayah that I just mentioned is 165 in Surah An-Nisa. Ayah 165, Surah An-Nisa. And then Allah says in another ayah, in Surah Al-An'am, ayah 48 to 49, Allah says, وَمَا نُرْسِلُ الْمُرْسَلِينَ, we do not send messengers. إِلَّا مُبَشِّرِينَ وَمُنذِرِينَ, except that they give glad tidings and they give what? They warn. فَمَنْ آمَنَ, anyone who believes in them. وَأَصْلَحَ, and he perfects his situation. فَلَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ, then there's nothing for him to be scared of. وَلَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ, and there's nothing for you to be... When the Quran uses فَلَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ, خَوْف and حُزْن together, it means خوف of what awaits you on the other side, the hereafter. And الحزن means here, وَلَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ, it means the hereafter that you've just left. Because you remember, you're worried about your children and your family and what you've left behind. وَلَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ, here means what? So there's nothing to be scared of when you meet the angels and you see their faces and this new different creation that you're meeting. You're going to go to a different dimension, a different world. Don't be scared. You've done good. What did you do? You believed in the messengers. آمَنَ وَأَصْلَحَ, and you perfected your situation. You changed. You follow what the messengers came with. Then there's nothing for you to be scared of, and there's nothing for you to what? To be saddened about for leaving your family members behind and those you've left behind. وَالَّذِينَ كَدَّبُوا بِآيَاتِنَا, those who disbelieved in our verses. يَمَسُّهُمُ الْعَذَابُ, the punishment of the hellfire will touch them. بِمَا كَانُوا يَفْسُقُونَ بِسَبَبِ فِسْقِهِمْ, because of their transgression and their wrongdoing. So this one is permissible. This one is called what? Wasa'id, which is shar'iyah, it's legislated. Pay attention, sisters and brothers. Question. Do the Ahlul Bid'ah today, do they take this type of wasa'id? Do they take this one? I'm asking you guys a question. No. They celebrate a birthday of the Prophet. They have no... Who told you this? Sah? So they leave off the intermediary that's legislated. Sah? And they come with the second type of intermediary, which is what? The prohibited one, the shirky one. And that is placing between Allah and the creation somebody... So placing between Allah placing between the creation and the creator, somebody who brings about manafi', good, and he repels evil from you. He's the one who brings you food. He's the one who gives you victory. He's the one who guides you. جلب المنافع ودفع المضار. This is a wasa'id, which is shirkiya. It's a shirki type. You can find more of this in the book of Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, Al-Wasitati Bayn al-Haqqi wal-Khalqi. And also in his list, if you go to his wasita, Bayn al-Haqqi wal-Khalqi, page 116, he expands on it more there, Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah. Also in his kitab al-Istighatha, first volume, page 230, seven. He also mentions it in his kitab Al-Furqan Bayna Awliya Ar-Rahman Wa Awliya Ash-Shaytan, page 549. Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen in his Majmu' Fatawa, 5th volume, page 279. Muhammad Al-Amin Al-Shanqiti in Adwa'ul Bayan, 2nd volume, 86. Qurtubi in his Tafsir, 6th volume, page 159. Summary now. The wasa'id are how many types? Two types. What's the first one? Shar'iyya, legislated. And who is this one? The messengers and the prophets. Good. And the second one is wasa'id, which is shirkiyya. Hey, this is what? Worshipping besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Believing that there's somebody who's going to bring you good, repel harm from you, besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Point number four. The evidences that indicate that the person who places between him and Allah, wasa'id shirkiyya, the second type, that this is kufr. Allah said in the Quran, وَالَّذِينَ اتَّخَذُوا مِن دُونِهِ أَوْلِيَاءَ مَا نَعْبُدُهُمْ إِلَّا لِيُقَرِّبُونَ إِلَى اللَّهِ زُلْفَى إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَحْكُمُ بَيْنَهُمْ فِي مَا هُمْ فِيهِ يَخْتَلِفُونَ إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَهْدِي مَنْ هُوَ كَاذِبٌ كَفَّارٌ Ayah 3, Surah Zumar. So Allah Ta'ala tells us in this ayah that the disbelievers, kuffar of Quraysh, what were they doing? They were worshipping besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they were saying, we're not worshipping them except to get us closer to Allah. The only reason why we're doing that is that these idols and these people that we're worshipping is to get us closer to Allah. Then Allah tells us in the ayah, at the ending of the ayah, Inna Allah la yahdi, Allah does not guide the one who is what? Kadib, he's a liar, and he's a kafar, he's a disbeliever. Also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says in Surah Yunus, ayah 18, وَيَعْبُدُونَ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ مَا لَا يَضُرُّهُمْ وَلَا يَنْفَعُهُمْ وَيَقُولُونَ هَؤُلَاءِ شُفَعَاؤُنَا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ قُلْ أَتُنَبِّئُونَ اللَّهَ بِمَا لَا يَعْلَمُ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَلَا فِي الْأَرْضِ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى عَمَّا يُشْرِكُونَ Ayah 18. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us they worship besides Allah that which does not benefit them, nor does it harm them. And they say, these are our shufa'a, intermediaries. At the ending of the ayah, what did Allah refer to it as shirk? He said, "Wa ta'ala Allahu amma yushrikun." Exalted and high is Allah, that which they associate with Him. Shirk, Allah referred to it as. Good. The statement of the Shaykh when he said, "Yas'aluhum shafa'ah," they asked them for intercession. What does shafa'ah mean in the language? Ibn Faris in Mu'jam Maqayis al-Lugha, page 531. In his book, Mu'jam Maqayis al-Lugha. This book I advise you to buy. This kitab is a dictionary. Mu'jam Maqayis al-Lugha, it's a dictionary. It's good for a student of knowledge when he's learning the language to buy this book. What is it called? Mu'jam Maqayis al-Lugha. Why is this book good? What's the beauty about this book? The beauty about this book is that Ibn Faris, he will find a word. Many have explained and they translate, so they explain this word to mean four or five different meanings. Maybe two meanings, three meanings sometimes four, sometimes even more. What he does is that he tries to find one meaning that it what? That the word revolves around. That all those five, when they're mentioning it, one thing they have in common. Or two that they have in common. If he can't do it in one, he tries to make it to the minimum that he can. Sometimes he makes it one, sometimes he makes it in two. Are we together? So it's nice for you because you don't want to memorize all five, sah? You want to know the minimum, sah? So he tries to bring it to one meaning. So it's a very good kitab.